What's up guys, my name is Kidron, and today I'm going to be doing an unboxing and a review of the Sony a7S Mark II, so let's get into it. So like a lot of people, I've had Canon cameras for a long time and I love them. I'm actually shooting on one right now, and I have a lot of Canon lenses. But Nikon and everyone started going to 1080p 60 on their full frames and on lots of their cameras, and Canon wasn't, and I couldn't figure out why. So I started looking into it, and obviously the 1DC has 1080p 60, and then some of their upper level cinema cameras do, but nothing at kind of the same price point as their competitors. So I actually called B&H to talk to one of their Canon reps and ask him some questions, and he was nice, but he said he didn't really know much more than I did, so he referred me to Canon camera. So I called Canon and talked to one of their reps. They told me basically what I already knew. I either had to go with the 1DC or the C300 Mark II to really get anything close to what the a7S does. The C300 Mark II is like $16,000. It'll do 1080p at 120 frames per second and it'll do 4K, but at $16,000, it's not a competitor. And same thing with the 1DC, it'll do 1080p 60, not even 120, and it'll do internal 4K, but you can get them for maybe $6,000 or $7,000. So again, that doesn't compete with the a7S Mark II. So basically, with Canon bodies, there's not really a competitor. So, like a lot of people, I actually went out, I sold my 5D3, and I bought the a7S Mark II. So without knowing a whole lot, I've heard about S-logs, I've heard about the crop to APS-C mode, for 1080p 120. I've heard lots of things about it, but I'm actually about to get my hands on it and test it out, and I'm going to tell you guys kind of what I'm learning, and it is a learning process for me. So I'm going to be telling you guys kind of what I'm learning, hopefully give you some good tips, and let you know what I find out. So here we go. All right, here we go. I just got this in from B&H a few days ago. If you want to watch the whole unboxing with all the details, you can click this link, or if you're on mobile, then go down to the description and click the link there. So first off, I got my batteries out and started charging them. Then I just picked up the camera and held it and immediately discovered something I needed to fix. The little mounts where you attach the camera strap were really noisy, so I removed those. You just take the little plastic thing off and then you can just twist off the metal part. So I got the manual out and started reading through it. I know it's weird, but I learned some really good stuff. So next I wanted to mount my lenses, and since I have all Canon glass, I had to use my Metabones adapter. And I'm sure you can get away with a cheaper adapter, but from everything I've read, Metabones is a little bit faster autofocus, a little stronger build, and it has a lot of firmware updates that can make sure everything keeps working well. Mounting it was actually a little tricky. First, I tried mounting the Metabones directly to the body, and first I couldn't figure out which way it was going because it was really hard in both directions, but you have to turn it pretty hard to get it onto the body, but then it's good. So I mounted my lens on the Metabones first, and then I was able to mount that on the body. But after using it on a couple shoots, I discovered that sometimes the lens won't click in exactly right onto the Metabones. So this can cause the edge of your subject to kind of double, and I noticed it before I even started recording, and then I clicked it right into place. So once you click the lens in, that goes away. But just be aware of that. So my battery grip came in and I got it mounted really easily. It just mounts up inside where you would normally put the battery and then screws on to the bottom mount. It's really nice to have two batteries, and it automatically uses one of them and then goes on to the next, whereas when I had Canon it would just kind of drain both simultaneously. And you can see in the upper right hand corner on the screen the little icon that shows how much is left on each of the batteries. And my first one was actually dead, so I was using the second one in this shot right here. But it's really nice to have this there. And it really doesn't chew through batteries as much as I thought it would from what I read. So as I was investigating and learning as much as I could, I looked up a Philip Bloom seminar on the a7S, and you can click here and watch it, or I put the link down below in the description as well. And from watching this, I learned some really good stuff about the custom buttons and picture profiles. I set 4 custom buttons on mine. C4, I made white balance, so I can just get to that and change white balance with a click or two. Then C3, I made the audio level set, and it's really nice to have this because while you're filming and in the middle of a recording, you can actually click and change your volume in like 1 second. C2, I made the focus magnifier to help when I'm manually focusing, which I do most of the time because the lenses I have aren't super fast with Sony. And this is really weird, but I'm actually noticing a huge difference between the focus magnifier on Sony versus Canon. I like how it looks on Canon a whole lot better. Even with focus peaking turned on the Sony, it's hard for me to tell when things are really in focus. On Canon, it's a lot easier, but I guess I'll get used to it. But focus peaking was another thing I picked up from the Philip Bloom seminar, and it's really nice to have as well. and C1 I set to the steady shot toggle, so I can have steady shot on or off. I like to have it on for some shots if I'm on a monopod or something like that, but when I'm using my glide cam, I usually try to turn it off because it gives the footage a really weird look, because with glide cam it's already pretty smooth and it just kind of overcompensates and it looks weird when steady shot's on. I couldn't find a way to put APS-C toggle on any of the custom buttons, and it's really annoying because it's one thing I really need to do pretty quickly on a shoot. If I have my 16-35 on, I like to have that for wide glide cam shots, but then I wish there was a way to quickly get into APS-C mode so I could get a tighter shot. You can do it through the menu pretty quick, but I wish that there was a custom button for it. APS-C is also not available on 4K mode, obviously, because you need the rest of the sensor. If you were in APS-C, you couldn't do 4K. And I really wish you didn't have to use crop mode on 1080p at 120 frames per second, though. It's really annoying. Another little quirky thing I've come across is the auto switch from the screen to the viewfinder. And it's nice to have the viewfinder option in live view. Philip Bloom was talking about how much sharper it is and how much easier it is to tell when things are in focus. And that's true. If you're on a tripod, monopod, handheld, whatever, it'll help. But on glide cam, and I was doing a slider shot for an interview the other day, and I can't put my face up to it to see what's in focus. Sometimes it's really annoying. It gets annoying when you're reaching across to hit the menu button or something, the screen will just turn off. Picture profiles was another good thing I picked up from the Philip Bloom seminar. There's a ton of options here. Not only are there a lot of picture profiles to choose from, but in each one, completely editable, there's like 50 submenu options. Under the gamma submenu is where you'll find the all popular S-Log options that everyone loves, and they give you the 14 plus stops of dynamic range, and they're wonderful. But one thing Philip Bloom said, and that I agree with as I've been messing with it, is you don't really need the S-Logs. If you use Cine 4, it's basically the same amount of dynamic range as the S-Logs, but the minimum ISO limit is 200 instead of 1600, and on an older a7S it was 3200. So I would recommend testing out the Cines because they don't have the minimum ISO requirements like the S-Logs do, and they're almost the same amount of dynamic range. Another thing I learned was to put the detail when you go in to the picture profiles, go into the submenu and put your detail down all the way to the minimum setting, so there's no in-camera sharpening. It's really easy to add sharpening in post, but it's hard to take it away. The last big thing I discovered, which actually took me a little bit, was how to have full manual controls in movie mode. So when you're in the manual mode on the dial, you obviously have full manual controls over all of your exposure, but you can't control the audio levels when you're trying to film. Whereas when you're in movie mode on the dial, you have audio controls, but by default it's set to profile and it's not going to let you change exposure except for the ISO. And I thought this was just stupid, and I knew there'd be a way to around it. So eventually I figured out if you go into the function menu on the bottom right, you can change it from profile over to manual mode in the movie mode. And I like to keep my dial in the movie mode so I have all of the controls for filming, and also just put that into manual under the function button so that I have full exposure controls as well as the audio controls. And that's the nicest setup that I've found. So I tested out all the movie modes, and I love the fact that you have 1080p at 120 frames per second, but I hate the fact that it crops to APS-C. And after using it a few times, I actually just bought an 11-16mm lens because I like to shoot pretty wide, and at crop that's just about the same as my 16mm on full frame. The 1080p 60 is awesome. Most other full frames except Canon have this option now, and it's great. It looks really nice. I've used this a lot on some commercial shoots and things that I've done. And this is actually the first time I've had this option on a full frame, so I love it. The 4K looks incredible, no complaints there. So I did some low light testing, and I didn't go into as much detail as a lot of people, but I did just a simple little test where I did 1000 ISO, 10,000, and 100,000. So it's actually not as amazing as I thought it would be. At 1000 ISO, there's not much noticeable noise, which is to be expected, but at 10,000, there is a good bit of noise, but with a little noise reduction, it's probably usable. But at 100,000 ISO, there is a lot of noise. And I mean, this is to be expected. It's 100,000 ISO, it's pretty high. But I don't think I could do anything really with this footage without some extensive correcting in post. And I'm honestly just not good enough in post at noise reduction and things to really work with that. You might be able to, but right now I'm not. And so these three shots were in 4K. And by the way, I know it looks pretty weird and like it's kind of shaky. And the reason was, I was talking before about turning off steady shot when I'm on the glide cam. This is a perfect example of how weird steady shot can be when you're using some type of stabilizer. So I would recommend turning steady shot off when you're on a glide cam, steady cam, movie, whatever. So back to low light, when you shoot in APS-C mode, the noise is a lot more prominent because you're cropped in a lot more on the sensor. These shots right here were actually just at 8,000 ISO, which I mentioned before, 10,000, there wasn't a ton of noise, but when you're in APS-C mode, this noise is a lot more noticeable. So that can make it kind of tricky when you're doing high speed shots in low light. But the fact that you have this option and you can boost your ISO and you can do slow-mo on this camera, I think it's still a win. And by changing different things on the picture profiles, like the sharpening and using maybe with the S-logs and things like this, you can get less noise. It's gonna be a little trickier to figure out the best combination for what you're trying to do, but I think there are workarounds for most of these things and you can get lower noise, but it may be some more work in editing as well. All right, there you have it. That is the Sony a7S Mark II. I've spent a week with it. I've learned so much stuff, both from watching Philip Bloom, from reading through the manual, and just mostly just from hands-on, you know, using it. It's a really good camera. I think it was hyped too much. I think because of all the hype, people expected it to be just incredible and it'll perform like a Red or an Arri. It doesn't. But it's only $3,000 compared to those cameras. That's not much at all, but it's a really good camera. I was a little bit disappointed with the low light. I love the fact that it can do 120 frames per second, but I wish it wasn't cropped. But you know, these are just things that you have to deal with and you have to find workarounds for them. So I ordered a new lens to get past the crop thing. I think using different color profiles and just figuring out what picture profile works best will help me a lot with the low light and getting better low light performance. I figured out how to get manual controls on the movie mode, helped a whole lot, and use steady shot only in certain situations. Sometimes, like the glide cam shots, it just isn't gonna work. So I've made a lot of mistakes, but I've learned a whole lot of stuff. I'd buy the camera again. I think it's a good camera, and I'm gonna be using it as my main camera for a long time, probably. And at the price point, I think it's great. I don't have any complaints there. If it was a $10,000 camera, I'd have a few more things to say. But it's only $3,000, and that's a lot of money. Don't get me wrong, $3,000 is a lot of money. I had to sell a camera and put a lot more into it to get it. But it's a good camera. It opens up a lot of possibilities. It's 4K internal. That's really cool. So obviously have a whole lot more to learn. I'm going to be using it a lot more. Please like and share this video. Put comments down below. I'm sure there's things I missed, so just let me know those things. And lastly, make sure to subscribe to my main channel, Kid Canon TV. That's where you'll see all my footage in action, real life situations, and actual videos I've made. And you'll be seeing videos with this coming out soon, I'm sure. So thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe. Peace.